Welcome to today's event, When Home is Where the Harm Is, Family Law Reform to Challenge Gender-Based Violence. I'm Terri Gordon, Director of the Gender Studies Program at the New School. I'm delighted to welcome the Women's Learning Partnership back to the New School this year. In her book, The Atrocity Paradigm, philosopher Claudia Card called domestic violence terrorism in the home. She used the word terror deliberately because it is often very difficult, if not impossible, for women and children to escape the confines of an abusive marriage or home. Today, when terrorism has taken such a predominant place in the national and international discourse, it is important to look at the ways in which terror pervades our most intimate spaces. WLP has assembled an international panel of experts and activists in the field of human rights to address domestic violence from the standpoints of law, politics, culture, and human rights. There will be a lunch break between the two panels, and you are all invited to take part in the reception in the atrium. It is an honor to introduce Mahnaz Afkhami, president and founder of WLP and former Minister of State for Women's Affairs in Iran. Mahnaz Afkhami has been a leading advocate of women's rights for over three decades. She founded the Association of Iranian University Women and served as Secretary General of the Women's Organization of Iran before the 1979 revolution. Her publications include Faith and Freedom, Women in Exile, Leading to Action, a Political Participation Handbook for Women, and Victories Over Violence, Ensuring Safety for Women and Girls. Many thanks to Ethics, Power, and Justice at the Schools of Public Engagement and Gender and Sexuality Studies at the New School for Social Research for co-sponsoring this event. I am also grateful to Pamela Tillis, Director of Public Programs at the Schools of Public Engagement, for her support of this program. Finally, I would like to thank my assistants in gender studies, Sam Morrison and Keith Jones, for all their help with this event. And Mahnaz.
Good morning, everybody. Is this working?
Yeah.
We're competing with the St. Patrick's Day parade, so men, even the saints are all men. But in any case, we'll get our people in gradually, I'm sure. I want to thank Terri and her department, and actually the New School group, who have been so supportive. This is the sixth year that we are doing this program at the New School, and they have been beyond collaborative and supportive sisters. So thank you, Terri, for all this, and your colleagues in the gender and sexuality studies, as well as the ethics, power, and justice. So today we are actually together to get thoughts from experts and activists from several regions of the world on the issue of family laws. And we are launching a three-year program that WLP has begun on connecting violence against women with the articles of family laws. You know, when we look around the world, we see such a lot of violence, conflict, all sorts of crumbling of institutions and values that we've all worked so hard to achieve. And we see unheard of kinds of denials of rights, almost preposterous statements, one ethnic group, one society, one culture against another, and also savage acts that don't make any sense in this day, in this age. But I think that we sometimes forget to see, or we're not even allowed to remember, because of the media being a co-conspirator in all of these images that we're bombarded with, the other side of the story. And the other side of the story doesn't take too much thinking to see. For instance, we were here, many of us, in 2000, when an unprecedented number of heads of state gathered, some 149, to create the Millennium Development Goals that had at that time only eight, and only one of them had to do with women. And right now, we are looking at the Sustainable Development Goals, some decade and a half later. And that one basically has 17 goals and 169 items. The previous ones, as I said, were so limited with regards to women. The new ones, almost all across, intersect and interact with women's issues. And this tells us something. It tells us something that even though the situation on the ground is often horrendous, the thing that has happened, which is priceless, is the level of consciousness, the level of awareness, which seems strange that it has taken so long to get into people's heads. And that is that you can't get anything done, anything, without 50% of the population. And the 50% that is the keeper of all the other, the grower, the trainer, the caretaker of the other 50% most of the time. So finally, it seems to have sunk home, and we have that to build on. And our partnership, WLP's partnership, we are a collection of 20 organizations. And it's not as if we had a set of ideas and we went and tried to find a branch or find like-minded people who wanted to follow a specific agenda that we had predetermined. We started with five organizations. Together we created what we wanted to do. And later, others joined us until we stopped at 20. We stopped at 20 because we wanted to have this interactive, collaborative, dialogue-based organization. So we stayed at 20. We meet regularly every year for 7 days and think together, where are we, where do we want to go? But each of us acts like the WLP International, that is, each of the partners also has partners who get together, who think together, who collaborate, and who determine their future course together. At the beginning, when we met at Beijing, the five organizations, at the beginning we thought of, with all these 35,000 organizations that were there, what is the value added? How are we going to even add a new thing? And after a lot of thinking and brainstorming, we came to the conclusion that what we're facing is not necessarily limited to this particular area, like the environment, or this particular topic, like violence against women, or poverty. If we're going to find a way to change things, to really make change happen, we have to change the architecture of human relationships. That is, the culprit is not this group, that group, this practice, the other practice. It's the way we connect with each other, the way we work with each other, the way we exclude at every level decision making. And so working together in circumstances which encourage innovation, encourage creativity, encourage all sorts of commitment to a cause is the key to change. At that time in Beijing, when we were talking, we had just graduated from saying 30% inclusion of women makes a real difference, is a turning point. And then we were just getting to the slogan 50-50, we want to be equal. After very few years, we decided, it's not that we want to be 50% of a messy, disorganized, violent, over-competitive, not nourishing, nurturing, and humane world. So we don't want 50% of that. We want to really change the whole thing. So now we have, for a while, been thinking about the 100%. How do we change the 100%? And if you look back in the past century, there are very few acts of real horrendous violence. You know, we remember in the mid-century, in the 20th century, we were facing 20 million and more civilian casualties. We were facing almost 60 million people who were harmed or killed. So this wasn't anything that any woman had started or had a part in, let's face it. And so we want to actually have a world in which our voice is heard and we have a vision for the whole world and for all of us, our sons, our children, our brothers, our sisters, everyone. And we're not excluding the other gender. We want to work with them, but we want to work as equals. We don't want just a seat at the table. We want to have conversations on an equal basis. So again, we went back and thought, okay, having participatory interaction, learning to be tolerant, learning to be inclusive, which really takes a lot of learning. And it's not only certain parts of the world, it's the entire world that needs that. So it's that is, of course, very important. But at the base of all of that, at the basis of the architecture of human relationships, the building blocks, really, are the families. That's where a woman really learns that she doesn't count. Other things such as political decision-making, economic well-being and contribution, all of these are, of course, very important. But unless a woman has rights at the center of the building of society, it's not going to be applicable. If a woman becomes the president of the country, but still has to get her husband's permission to leave the country, no matter where she's going, there's no dignity in that. There is no self-reliance, there is no self-determination. If a woman can get divorced without having a say, almost verbally, sometimes written, if a woman cannot take a job without a husband's permission, if a woman cannot marry without her father's permission or her older brother's permission, if she cannot have the guardianship of her children, sometimes the guardianship of her children after the father's death even, go to an uncle or to a grandfather. If rape within marriage is not only condoned, it's the right of a man. So you see, family laws, and it's not only in certain countries. Actually, I think until the 1980s in the United States, a woman could not open a bank account without her husband's permission to start a savings account for a child. So this is actually how I became a feminist. When I was teaching at the university in Iran, I went to open an account for my child, and they told me I couldn't do it. My husband had to co-sign. And even when he co-signed, and I had the account, I couldn't withdraw without his permission. So I said, this is not fair. And then later I found how many unfair things there are, you know. And so the base of that is the family laws. So what we're hoping to do with your help is to explore how do we develop a campaign that actually connects items of family laws, and it doesn't have to be called a family law, because some countries call them a family status law. Some people have the same type of vision of a role of women, but in the civic law, some people have it in traditional or customary practices. Whatever it is called, we're talking about the role of a woman and the authority of a woman over her own life, her own well-being, her own decisions within the family context, which of course spreads to society as well. So we want to see how do we connect these, because after all, in the past we have talked of laws more in legislative ways. We have talked about similar legislation. We have talked about, in the Muslim majority countries, Sharia, which is a man-made set of laws based on religion. We have always tried to compare, okay, X country of similar background or culture has this item which is preferable to the one we have in this country with the same culture and religion. These kinds of pleas for please give us our rights. So now what we want to do, and now that we have succeeded in making violence against women a taboo, I think that is accepted. They perpetrate sometimes without impunity, often without impunity, but the idea of violence against women has become taboo. So we're going to try to form a campaign that ties marital rape, for instance, child marriage, or permission to move from one place to another, these as forms of violence against women. And we need all of your help in the dialogues that ensue with the wonderful people that we have assembled to find how are we going to do this. And we hope that this conversation will be global in scope, and that we will be able to help with each other to create a global conversation. Looking back to what has been accomplished in spite of the very horrendous decade and a half that we all have experienced, and in spite of the preposterous statements that we see all around us in the United States, in the Global South, in the Middle East, in Europe, where refugees are, as we all know, in this desperate situation, in spite of all of that, we have done so much, and we have the consciousness and the awareness that will help us to do a lot more. So I'm looking forward to this conversation very much. And now I would like to turn to Yakin Ertürk, the chair of the first panel. Yakin, of course, is a very special woman. She is the true academic, scholar, activist. And she's saying, oh my God, I'm going to hear all this again, but you need to know. Yakin, I admire very much because not only she's a thinker, former sociology professor, writer, whose coming book in English is being published by WLP, and it's called Violence Beyond Borders, and it's a wonderful book about which you will hear a lot. But Yakin has held almost every post of significance at the United Nations, except Secretary General, maybe in the future. She has been there. She has been, of course, Rapporteur, Special Rapporteur on Violence Against Women. She has headed INSTRA, and she has also been head of the Division on the Status of Women. After her, she really created the foundation for the UN Women, which came later and incorporated some of those roles. So what else can I tell you? So Yakin is going to lead the conversation and facilitate the next panel. So thank you very much for being with us.
Everybody. I mean, after that introduction, what can I say? I think Mahnaz forgot my most important task these days, or role. I'm the happy grandmother of two beautiful girls. And that's what counts, I think. And maybe they'll come later on today. But may I invite the panelists, please, to the podium? One of our panelists, Musimbi, is running a little late because of the traffic situation, I presume. So we have some remarkable women with us today. And I'm very happy to say that I have a personal history with each one of them, which I cherish very much. Well, this event, this collaborative event of the New School Gender Studies and WLP has really become a tradition. And I'm hoping that it will continue. Although I'm a little bit sad today because we're used to a full house. And today, I appreciate those who have made it, no doubt. But the ones who have not made it, they're going to lose. So I don't know how we're going to compensate that. Well, Mahnaz has already talked about the significance of this year's event. It is a launch of the WLP program on family law and violence against women. She has already talked about the rationale of this project, and I'm hoping that as the project unfolds and produces new knowledge and experience, we will have an opportunity to share with the wider community. Women's advancement in all parts of the world, although still lags terribly behind the standards that we aspire to, but there have been very significant achievements in the area of education, health, political participation, and so forth. Achievements that would have been non-imaginable just a couple of decades ago. So things have moved despite all the obstacles that we are facing. But we have also seen that it's not enough to have a college degree or beyond. It's not enough to be in the parliament. It's not enough to have achieved many of these development indicators that we cherish so much. If women's lives are confined to the rules and regulations of patriarchy, which are instituted in laws and values and so forth. So that's where I think laws matter. Yesterday we had another WLP event, and my dear colleague Sreida Husseini from Palestine said, bad laws are better than good laws. I certainly agree with that. Because unless rules and regulations are codified into law, we have nothing to work with. Then it is totally up to someone with authority to dictate. Now, when there is a law, do we escape that? Absolutely not. Because most laws are very much ingrained in patriarchal values. And Mahnaz talked about a woman who could lead a country but needs a husband's permission to leave the country. And these are not imaginary situations. I have witnessed myself in my various country visits. However, laws provide us with a framework, and I think the women's movement has worked with the international human rights law, changing its content and also using it to enforce change in their respective countries. And it's an ongoing struggle. It's a difficult one, and I think these days we all feel a little bit subdued and feel this is not going anywhere. But it hasn't been easy in the past either, so let us not give up and let us not resort to such resignation. We need to continue the struggle, and I think younger generations, which may not have been part of this movement lately, are going to find it that this is their case, and they're going to come on board. So laws do matter, and family law in particular is the core of power, and it translates into what happens in the economy, in the society at large. So in this sense, family law reform is absolutely a key priority for women everywhere. But when these laws are derived, said to be derived from religion, such as in the case of Sharia, which I think many of the MENA region countries are implicated with, then the struggle becomes all the more difficult for women because you're fighting against a sacred force. And patriarchy uses this very effectively to discredit the movement. But this hasn't stopped women. Throughout the MENA, I think family law reform today is a major priority. And the Moroccan family law reform of 2004 has become sort of a good practice which we all refer to. So this project, I think, is going to contribute to our understanding of what's happening on the ground, not only in countries where Sharia, the laws are derived from the Sharia, but even secular law, such as my country, Turkey, where in implementation, of course, things don't stop with good laws either. So there are many dimensions to struggling for equality and rights. I shall stop there because I think our panelists are going to contribute to, this will be sort of a first initiative for the WLP project, and I think we're going to get some really interesting insight. Of course, each of our panelists come from very diverse backgrounds, and you have their bios, so I'm not going to go over, take time to go over those. Our first speaker, I'm going to go in the order that it is listed in this program. Musimbi Kanyoro from Kenya, who is the president of Global Fund for Women, is running a little late, so when she comes, she will join us. To my right is Jacqueline Pitangu from Brazil, and I take the pleasure of being board of as members of boards of directors of WLP. So we have been working together for a number of years now, and I very much respect and enjoy her the engagement with her. Madeline Rees, again, someone I have a wonderful history with and a woman whom I admire tremendously. Her dynamism is something I can't beat, but it inspires me. Madeline, of course, is the Secretary General of Women's Institute, International League for Peace and Freedom, and has recently done part of the work. She was part of the team that did the evaluation of 1325, which I think is so critical. And Dubravka Simonovic, again, someone I have been engaging with since my days, horrifying days as director of DOL. Oh my goodness, those were very difficult days, preparing for the Beijing Plus Five and so forth, but someone who gave me her support. She was a delegate at the time from Croatia. But then our paths crossed constantly, a former CEDAW member and chair of CEDAW, and now she's holding the current position. She's the current rapporteur on violence against women, which I had the great pleasure of doing for 6 years, from 2003 to 2009, something I think has sort of added to my whole perspective on women's rights and human rights in general. So, Jacqueline, may I turn the floor over to you, please? And if we can take like 10 minutes or so, and then maybe we'll have second rounds later on.
Okay, thank you, Yakin. It's a pleasure to be here with this extended WLP family and be here at the new school again. I'll go very quickly. Just pointing out that laws are written with the political pen, that they reflect the dynamics of the political forces in a given time, in a given society, that they are historical, and that therefore they can change. They reflect the social, economic relations, and they operate as well as to the advancement or to the repression of human rights. And I think that laws are key. Some people say, oh, why deal with laws? I believe that laws are key because they are really the instruments that gives us a ground from which to depart, or a ground to be defended, or a ground to be modified in some way or another. I think that when we take the other dimension of the WLP new project, it's violence against women and family law, we have the same reasoning in relation to violence and violence against women. I think violence is also a historical concept. The meaning of violence changes along the time and can even change at the same time in a given complex countries where you have different diverse religious or ethnic groups. So violence is also a very dynamic historical concept. It is possible to change what a society perceives as violence in a given time, in a given moment, and what is punished as a crime in a given time, in a given moment, because it doesn't go necessarily together. So I think this connection between laws that regulate the relations within the family, be it by family loss, as in certain countries, or civil code, as in secular countries like mine, Brazil. They are key, and they make clearly a linkage with violence. It's a mutual reinforcement between family law and violence. Well, and I think that to understand both family laws, I'm going to talk about family laws, even if sometimes I'm referring to civil codes, and violence against women in a given society, we should go beyond what is written on the laws and understand what is the situation of the women in society at large. I mean, we have to pay attention if we want to understand how the relations within the family are regulated by the state. We have to understand also what's happening on the penal codes that will regulate certain kinds of what is historically defined or recognized as crime against women, where you usually have embedded issues of honor crimes, issues of adultery, etc. So when you take civil and penal code, being one, usually a private one, that will regulate this so-called private world of relations between the individuals, and the penal code being the public one, you will see clearly the need to understand the position of the women in society at large, in the labor market, the labor code, and the workforce, education, politics. I mean, what is the broad situation of women in society at large that is reflected or is not reflected, because sometimes reality changes and the laws are slow, but what is there between the real situation of women in society and the laws that regulate both the private and the public sphere? And when we do that, we must look, for instance, and play a key role, the stereotypes in education that reinforce subalternity on a girl's education. We should look at obstacles for her political participation. What I want to say is that discrimination at large against women, present in different dimensions of life, reinforce discriminatory civil codes, family laws, and violence against women. And in this particular, it's also important to have in mind that crime and punishment, as I said, are historical concepts. We have changed this. We women, with our activism, have changed the concepts of crime and punishment in the world, more in certain contexts than others, but there is a change. It's dynamic. I will briefly, for instance, give an example of Brazil, where the man who was accused of having murdered his wife or his friend or his partner, the defense lawyers would say that that happened because he was under extreme emotion. It was always related to sexuality, and he did that in the legitimate defense of his honor. So this was not a law, this was the interpretation of a law, two arguments put together, and how did that change? Through the political work of women, until the Superior Court of Justice said the honor of a man is not on a woman is not the property of the man, so the honor is on himself and his behavior. This argument cannot be used anymore. That took decades of working for that, but it changed. It changed in the jury tribunals, the less and less you use or accept this argument. So I will give few examples of progress and challenges in Brazil, but as I said, I will be focusing on my country where I work, I know better, but it's universal trends that we're pointing out here. Discriminatory laws, particularly those that regulate family relations, and that justify domestic violence, and that allow for the social acceptance, in which this is very, very important, and the invisibility of the violence within the home. The civil code, where we have the legislation regulating family relations, has always been a target for women's movement in Brazil, a key target. And this even during the time of dictatorship, where women tried to assess the Congress with a law reform proposal. However, this really will be changed only after the 1988 new constitution. And until then, from 1916, beginning of the last century, until 1988, family relations were regulated by a civil code, as I said, from the beginning of last century. And women at the time of that civil code were not even able to vote. We didn't have the right to vote when we had the civil code regulated. We were not recognized as citizens. Voting in Brazil came only in 1932. The code is from 1916. So this general situation of second-class citizen in society was clearly reflected in the civil code. Clearly state that the man is the head of the family. And this simple phrase, the man is the head of the family, brings along so many consequences, affects deeply the life of the woman, not only within the space of the home, but her position in the outside world. For instance, a woman could not, as Mahnaz said, open a bank account. She had to have a man's permission to do so. In regards to the common properties and goods and wealth, it was the man who always took the last and definitive decision on what to do, how to apply, etc., even if the wealth or part of it was brought by the woman. He was the one who was the main responsible for the children. Children that were born out of the marriage were not recognized. It was the woman who determined the residence. So if both worked and he was sent to the Amazon, she had to go. I mean, there was no at all sense of equality between men and women, as there was not in real life. But then comes a moment that this code of law becomes totally in disparity what women were doing in reality. Women were in the labor force, and women were engaging less and less in marriages at an early age, etc. And then at the Constitution, we did a strong campaign and advocacy to change the laws. I remember we had a picture of a traditional family beginning of the last century, the man very well dressed with a watch like this, huh? And the rest of standing up and the rest of the family around him, the woman like this, and we would say, you see, this picture is the picture of a family, and this family has not changed in that picture, but in reality it has, and the laws are in accordance with that picture, not with reality as it is. It was a very powerful message, and we were able to have the Constitution with one single phrase, make this code totally suppressed, because they say men and women have equal rights, duties, and responsibilities in the marriage. So this level of equality stated in a constitutional provision made it automatically necessary to reform the family civil code. And that was a major advancement. That was a moment of democratization of the country and democratization of the relations within the home. So what I want to say to finish is that struggling for loss is key. It has to happen. And in different contexts, we do have some instruments that will help us to advance, like CEDAW, like the Plan of Action for Cairo, in my case, in the Americas, the Belém do Pará Convention. And whenever we can use international human rights instrument to legitimize our action, we should do it. I think that we have now, to finish, the huge challenge of implementing laws. And there are so many variables that interfere: culture, religion, the political context, what's happening now in that country. In my country, we see an advancement of very fundamentalist Christian right wing, but the laws are there, they are to be implemented, and it is our role to defend them and to monitor the application. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Jacqueline. Sorry. I think two messages are very clear: that laws are man-made, therefore they can be changed, no matter what it is claimed to be based on. So this is a very empowering starting point for women to start their struggle or continue their struggle. And I think the point that democracy is not something that happens out there, yeah, but it starts at home. This is a very important point. And if decision makers, politicians, international figures can only realize this, and I'm sure they do realize, but if they can stick to this, then their policies and the things that they promote sometimes that sort of overlooks what happens in the private sphere will not be defendable. I think we need to keep pushing this. And Eduardo Galeano, who passed away 2 years ago, I think very eloquently put it that human rights starts at home. So thank you very much for those words. Madeline, may I give the floor to you, please?
Thank you very much. What a great initiative for the Women's Learning Partnership. I think this is really so crucially important because this is exactly where transformation can take place. And I will echo Jacqueline completely and Yakin in terms of never give up on law. What law must do is must actually reflect the real experiences of what people have so that it can actually then be relevant to our lives. But I'm going to start with a story. In 2006, I got married. You think, so what? Except I got married to a woman who was then 9 months pregnant, and we were amongst the first in Britain to avail ourselves of the possibilities of getting married. And it was actually quite hysterical because the people who, after my partner gave birth, we then had to go and register little babe, and they'd all done the training, so they would say, so who's the mother? Oh, sorry, not who's the mother, because you're both the mothers. Who's the birth mother? So they got the narrative right, and we're very fine and very welcome, very warm. We then moved to France, and in France, register little babe in school, no problem at all. Absolutely accepted. Even now, moved to South Africa, and I say even now, she's in a Russian school. And nobody bats an eyelid except when I try to say Zdravstvuyte and do it very badly. That means good morning, if you could understand any of my attempts at Russian. So it's fine. It has been a way of a family unit being recognized and transforming attitudes towards what was seen as something which was taboo. That is an idea of a lesbian couple forming a family with a little babe. That is crucial in terms of showing the power of law in transforming social constructs and the power of the family in being part of that transformation. Just after we had done our registration of little babe, we were followed by a little old lady who came in. That sounds very patronizing, but she was very small. And she said, I want to register for one of those new things. And the one behind said, what's one of those new things? You know, that civil partnership. Me and my friend, we want to have a civil partnership. It's not what you think, but what she wanted to do was she knew that law would come in to protect her and her friend if they registered a civil partnership in terms of automatic inheritance rights, the right to accessing proper healthcare and information about your partner's healthcare, all of those things that come from the recognition of that family unit would then be theirs. Now, I wish I could stop there because you'd all have a nice warm fuzzy moment and think, oh, isn't that nice? We can all do this. But of course, families and all of us are subject to the slings and arrows of outrageous fortune, and the outrageous fortune that we are often subjected to is something which Yakin really knows more about than I dare mention, and that is political economy and the violence that can result from political economy. And it's that I want to turn to first of all when looking at the family as a unit. Political economy is about power. Who has it, how it's used, and it's highly gendered, and it's made more complicated by the intersection of different discriminations within that itself. But gender trumps it all. Yakin, as Special Rapporteur, did a tremendous amount of work in actually explaining how political economy works, as we follow with Jackie True in pushing that agenda so that it's become part of the feminist lexicon in better understanding how gender relations work. And I wasn't sure whether it was you or whether it was with Jackie who actually said that the gender division of labor and unequal power relations in marriage and the family affect the autonomy and ability of women to claim their human rights. Now, if you shrink that into what that actually means is if you are unable to exercise autonomy within a social constructed area of society, such as the family, then once you move outside that, you're not going to be able to either. So it spreads into the labor force where there is inequality, unequal pay, unequal conditions, unequal opportunities. It then inevitably feeds into the structures of the overall economy of that state. It then feeds into and is reinforced by the governance structures, because if you don't access your rights within your family, you don't access your rights in employment, if you can't access economic independence, chances of you actually being able to participate in governance structures and decision makers reduces, which means the laws which are then made by those institutions are not reflective of your reality, are not reflective of equality, and actually reinforce the inequalities in that socially constructed unit of the family, and we're stuck. So it's a beautiful self-fulfilling mantra. It also means that, you know, women tend to be greater impoverished and greater affected by issues such as austerity policies. And haven't you seen The Big Short? I saw that on the plane on the way over the other day. Very good. They said, the throwaway line from Brad Pitt when they're betting against the crash of the housing market, 1 million unemployed, because they said there would be massive unemployment if the housing crisis did actually happen, which of course it did. 1 million unemployed leads to 40,000 deaths. Don't know where they got that figure from, but he said in a very compelling way, as only Brad Pitt can, 40,000 deaths. Bet you, if we did a gender analysis of how those deaths arose, it will be highly gendered, it'll be about access to healthcare, it'll be about ability to access adequate housing, sanitary facilities, and on and on. Economic austerity policies absolutely affecting the ability of the family to work, an equal relation, and then inevitable gender dimensions to that. So much of it is based in material wealth. Again, the material power has a material basis. Land ownership, ownership of houses, ownership of tools of production, fundamentally important as to who and in what way equality is enjoyed within the family. So in DRC, a friend of mine did a brilliant, brilliant assessment of the family unit and power structures in families in the Democratic Republic of Congo. She did it for UNDP, they didn't publish it because it showed overwhelmingly that women owned nothing. No tools, no land, no housing, and yet worked for 18 hours a day, whilst the man was doing 6, 8 maybe, and enjoyed the control of all that wealth. Again, how are those women going to be able to assert their rights? How are they going to be able to assert their access to law for protections, in particular protections against violence? Research has also shown that when women have material wealth, they own the land, they own the housing, they have rights over their children, the levels of violence are likely to be much, much less. So in fact, the way in which material possessions are enjoyed, power is enjoyed, will inevitably impact on the levels of violence which result. Two important dimensions that we have to consider in relation to this. One is austerity, which I mentioned briefly before, and the other one is militarism and its impact. In the United Kingdom, there are two women killed every week as a result of domestic violence. That's a massive increase, and it has been absolutely ad idem with the implementation of the politics of austerity, neoliberalism. Partly because of the ways in which it's impacted on the family unit, with unemployment, with lack of access to, particularly for impacting on women, access to early childcare, access to education in the localities, those sorts of issues which are highly gendered, but also in terms of the impact that it's had within the family unit in terms of accessing sufficient resources to even feed the children on occasion, leading and intensifying aggravations between relations, leading and intensifying violence against women, at the same time austerity cutting back absolutely on the provision of support services for women, so closing of shelters, lack of access to the sorts of services that were there before, so women stay within violent relationships and, as a result, 2 deaths per week. So economic choices made as a result of neoliberal policies directly affecting the family unit, directly leading to increased violence against women and death. In Ukraine, we have been doing some research, considerable amounts of research, on what is actually happening within societies which are most affected by the conflict in the East. There is a whole gender dimension to it, of course. But one particularly interesting interview showed that a woman was explaining that she's a lawyer, and her husband was called up and went to serve in the Ukrainian military. Before, they'd had a perfectly equal relationship. They had discussed, debated, made decisions jointly, had owned things jointly. He comes back, and that has all changed. He now barks orders at her and at the children, and has even raised his fist to her on occasion. What has happened to this guy? And interestingly, he hadn't even seen service at the front. He'd been in charge of logistics. But what you see there is the impact of a militarized situation on his relation to his family unit. And it's inimical because the power relations have all been broken. So no longer equality, inequality, leading to aggression and potential for violence. And not even the excuse that he's traumatized. And it's no surprise that, in fact, in all societies, Ukraine being absolute case in point, but Bosnia was, and every post-conflict situation, you see a massive increase in violence against women within the family. And that is as a result of the militarization, the militarized mindset, which causes then disparity, inequalities within the family unit, exacerbated by the economic problems caused by conflict. So we have two very major problems. We have the politics of austerity, and we have militarism, which is where we are now. How many of you are aware of the work of the Human Rights Council and its resolutions? I thought it was really important. That was one, I think. I'm so glad we spend so much time putting energy into getting right resolutions in the Human Rights Council. There is one on the protection of the family, a resolution on the protection of the family from 2014. It's a matter of great contestation, because the family unit being the fundamental structure of society and reflective of cultures. So they are fighting over what it would look like. Those who are opposed to it want the traditional family. They don't like families like mine. They want the traditional family, nice heterosexual, you know, the guy goes off to work, the woman stays at home, and you can use corporal punishment against your children, maybe. Anti-abortion, anti the rights of women to control the number and spacing of their children, so on and so forth. Those who are opposed to the resolution oppose all of that. They want people like me to have families and so on and so forth. Very good. I'm rushing because Yakin has told me I have to. So we have those two big contested space on that resolution. It did go through, but there are saving graces within it, because clearly there's a tension between individual rights and the rights of the family, when the family, recognized under international law from the Universal Declaration of Human Rights onwards, but never defined what it is, Is it mine? Is it yours? Or is it just everybody's? You know, families are different. So there's a potential for lots of interpretation of what the family unit would look like as an organizational structure. But we do have, and we do know, that individual human rights are and must be protected within that family unit. So it's everything from the right to privacy, to in having the right to control the number and spacing of your children, to have the right to equality, you know, all of those human rights which are implicit or explicitly defined within international law and which must be codified nationally in order to give effect to those obligations, they are there. So it's the tension. How do you do the protection of the individual rights, particularly the ones relating to violence, and protect the family at the same time? And that's where the tensions have been played out, because clearly, if you do not have implementation of those laws, particularly against domestic violence, because of this, it's located within a patriarchal system and it's not recognized, it will not be put into practice. So we have a huge problem with that tension and with the application of law. We should not give up on it. We must make it work. But when it sits in the context of austerity, then we have the problems I've just outlined previously. One of, very interestingly, this issue of the resolution on the protection of the family, it sits now within the context of a sustainable development goal, which I'm sure you're all totally involved with because that's the subject of CSW, which does insist that there be much greater attention paid to the recognition of the unpaid labor of women within the family as part of a development strategy. Now, if we have all that, that sounds great. You know, so basically, looking at unpaid work, looking at equality within the family, seeing the family as a potential driver of development, as a unit which doesn't say protection, but can be therefore utilized as an instrument of social development, as long as there is gender equality within it. Love it. Except that now sits in a context where we have neoliberalism, where we have increasing militarism within our societies, as we are witnessing from Europe to the United States to everywhere. And that plays back into the impact that is going to have on the family. So whilst, as a matter of law, we are stumbling towards a better understanding of how the family can exist as a structure with individual rights, and there can be development based on that as a social construct. It can be transformative of some of the ills that we've seen, but at the same time, we've made it almost impossible when we militarize and when we practice a neoliberal theory of economics and an ideology which actually destroys that aim. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Madeline. And I think we really need to reflect on all what you have said, because you made the connections of areas which are often perceived as being delinked. You know, the family is here, military is here, economy is here, whereas we can, this kind of an analysis is really something we need to constantly go back to. And you have also emphasized how important the concept of heterosexual normality is to this whole game, whether in times of war or within the home. And your personal success story is a horrifying thing for many states. That's why I think they were eager to pass this resolution. It's your fault. I mean, this resolution threatens me a great deal because this is backlash, which is instituting itself within the Human Rights Council. It's quite scary. So I think we need to be wary. And the point that you made with respect to the connection, the political economy, which is very dear to my heart, I think we have often, as feminist analysts, neglected to really link patriarchy and class. That's where it all fits in. Unless we are able to show that reproduction, whether biological or economic, are so intertwined, I think we will miss the whole story. So thank you very much for all that insightful analysis. Our Musimbi, welcome. But I will continue with the line of speak and then give you the floor. Dubravka, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much. Good morning to all. It is my honor as a UN Special Rapporteur on Violence Against Women, Its Causes and Consequences, to be here with you, and especially to be here when Yakin Ertürk is chairing this panel as a former UN Special Rapporteur on Violence Against Women, Its Causes and Consequences. I have inherited her reports and her work, and now I am trying to focus on priorities in front of us. Title of this panel is really excellent one, because when we look at this title, when home is where the harm is, we are seeing that it is actually the current situation for many girls and many women all over the world. And I'm very glad that Yakin mentioned that we met many, many years ago, and at that time she was director of the Division for the Advancement of Women, and at that time I was chairperson of the CSW. We were very innovative. It was hard time, but at that time we wanted to abolish agreed conclusions. And that was not possible, because we wanted to focus on global international norms that should be implemented and applied, and not to go through exercise each and every year about agreed conclusions on something that is current topic, but that is more or less repetition or non-repetition of what was already agreed but never implemented fully. I am very glad that Ms. Mahnaz Afkhami, founder and president of Women's Learning Partnership, mentioned at the beginning that now we do have sustainable development agenda that is different than previous millennium goals, and it is very important now to see where we are in terms of international norms and how we are applying those norms at the national level and what is actually happening at the level of homes and families. It was rightfully pointed out that now we do have agenda, sustainable development agenda with 17 goals, and we can say that for the first time the whole agenda is gendered agenda, because it is a requirement to have gender mainstreaming throughout all goals. And we do have specific standalone goal on achieving gender equality and empowerment of women. And also for the first time, it is notion on achieving gender equality, what is focus on results and focus on substantive equality. And empowerment of women, what is requiring different positive measures by states in order to accelerate advancement of women in many areas. Then what is also new is that for the first time under targets, in addition to elimination of all forms of discrimination against women, we do have elimination of violence against women in public and private sphere. Violence against women and girls, specifically mentioned, in public and private sphere. And after that, there is an elaboration of all harmful practices, specifically early girl-child marriage and female genital mutilation. But all others should be included, because it is just a few of them mentioned by example. So for the first time in such global agenda, we do have focus on elimination of violence against women and harmful practices. This is a big step forward, and now we have to see how to go from this global level to each and every society, family unit, and how to achieve this idea that each and every girl and woman should have right to live life free from violence. We are seeing that when we are looking at different forms of violence against women and girls, and what you will see in headlines and so on, mainly you will see focus on early forced girl-child marriage, practices like kukutwala, marital rape. You will see focus on situations when rapist who marries victims is not punished, polygamy, adultery that is differently treated with respect to women and men. You will see many cases related to domestic violence that are not really reported, that are, for example, rape is underreported, if reported, it is underprosecuted, if prosecuted, it is underpunished. So we are seeing that femicides are not really data are not really globally available. We do have data on homicides, not data on femicides. When we do have such data, they are not used as a preventive tool. And I have called all UN member states to establish femicide watch, to look into data on femicides, to analyze such data, and to focus on prevention of femicide cases in the future. But we are not yet there. Now I'm looking what is happening with respect to implementation of Millennium Sustainable Development Agenda, and now when UN member states are discussing statistical data, they are again looking on homicide data, not on femicide data. So there are things that are still in front of us, and there are different challenges. It seems to me that now we have to see how to move this, what we have achieved at the global level, down to national, regional level, national level, and then to the level of each and every community, and then to the level of home and family. If we look at the global level, there are also challenges at the global level. What I'm seeing now as a special rapporteur on violence against women, here I would like to mention that at the global level, although we do have a sustainable development agenda, we do have CEDAW convention and its optional protocol, we do have Beijing platform for action, we do have Security Council resolution. We have all those instruments, but they are not used jointly in a comprehensive manner. They are used as a separate documents by UN in general, but also by member states. And in the future, we need to change direction. We need to use those documents, be it global and also regional, because Belém do Pará was mentioned, New Istanbul Convention, Maputo Protocol. They all are covering, for example, issues related to family laws or personal status law. So they all have to be used in a manner that is really focusing on results at the national level. And we are not yet there. In terms of full acceptance of those global agenda that is there, we are also seeing that this is unfinished business. Because if you look at CEDAW Convention is not yet universally ratified by all countries. There are still some countries that are missing in this list. United States as a first one on the list, and I hope that in the future it is going to be done. But then if you look at the optional protocol was ratified by 104 states, and it is also a long way to go in order to have the same level of ratification as the convention. And optional protocol is now showing very clear results in terms of pointing out on deficits in terms of implementation, jurisprudence coming out from the CEDAW committee that is dealing with domestic violence is extremely important to show what is not done in line with international norms. There are also different inquiries that are focusing on gross or systematic violations of women's rights in different countries. CEDAW committee up to now did inquiries against Mexico, Philippines, and Canada. And in those cases, established gross or systemic violations of women's rights and pointed out different things that should be done at the national level. But the basic point is that those international norms like CEDAW, Beijing Platform for Action, they're either not fully accepted or not fully incorporated and then implemented. Implementation was also mentioned. But incorporation is another problem. I have seen that on many occasions, even countries when they do accept, when they do ratify, when they do have this political commitment, they see international law as declarations somewhere up in the I don't know, sky, and they're applying national laws. And here we are missing clear, effective application of international law at the national level. Judges do not have education about international treaties, about CEDAW Convention. They are not following jurisprudence. They are not knowing what is happening at the international level. Are we expecting them to apply those international norms? So there is a huge gap there that should be bridged in the future. And if you look at national level, even in the countries in which we do have acceptance of international norm, we do have incorporation, we do have in some countries incorporation, in the other countries domestication, we do have possibility to direct application of international law or incorporation to different pieces of national law. But even when they do all those steps, then at the end, if we look what is happening at the national level, we are seeing that there is a lack of holistic or comprehensive approach when we are speaking about elimination of violence against women. And it was already pointed out that with respect to family law, we could not look only at one piece of legislation, be it family law or personal status law. Because now we are seeing that in many countries there are constitutions as a starting point, and still in different constitutions all over the world, there are discriminatory provisions against equality between women and men. For example, you will see in constitutions of some countries, there is provision on prohibition of sex discrimination, but then there are exceptions with respect to personal status of family law. So this is hidden possibility for all those laws that still discriminate against women. And this is a huge challenge. This should be addressed forcefully at the national level. Then the huge problem that should be also mentioned is persistence of discriminatory gender stereotypes that really legitimize violence against women and different forms of discrimination against women. And this type of acceptance of discrimination is really starting at home, because at home we are receiving this first education as girls, future citizens of each society. And when we look at those norms, there are different forms of direct and indirect discrimination. There is hidden discrimination there that we are maybe recognizing only later when we are adults. And now when we are saying what is, for example, ongoing situation with respect to percentage of women or girls that faced violence, now we are coming to data that, for example, each third of us was victim of violence, any kind of violence here. But now I have really doubts. Maybe it is really not as it is. Maybe it is every second of us. Maybe it is each of us, but we are not speaking out. Because those norms are so deeply ingrained in our upbringing that it's easier not to say than to say that this violence is still accepted as normal, tolerated. When I was in different countries, when I was speaking to different survivors of violence, it was clear that they had perception that that was something normal, that was something acceptable. And only later on, during their process of empowerment, they learned that they need to object and they need to fight for their rights. So I think that this focus on family is an excellent focus, and I hope that with this study you will contribute to all area of hidden and not really fully visible discrimination that is starting within a family unit and that is really very persistent, that should be really changed. Thank you.
Thank you, Dubravka. I think your emphasis on the lack of data with respect to violence against women is really so important, because we're talking about violence. We say it increased, we say it decreased. Politicians like to say that it's just gained visibility. But how do we know, since in most countries there is very little comprehensive data and indicators, of course. So in that respect, I very much welcome your call for the Femicide Watch. I think we should all be keep this concept in our minds and support this. And those of you who are interested, on 10th of December, the last day of 16 days of activism, I did an interview with Dubravka as the new rapporteur. It was published on Open Democracy, the online platform, and I think you publish there quite a bit too. So those of you who have not used Open Democracy, I bring that to your attention. Very interesting articles appear there. Yes, we still have a long way to go, no matter whether we look at the international level or the national. And maybe Musimbi will give us some good news. The floor is yours, Musimbi. And I'm sorry you had horrible time in the traffic, probably.
I was a victim of St. Patrick's. Of course, we were warned, and I really thought I had given myself enough time to be warned, but I was wrong. Lots of streets closed. So anyway, I'm here. Thank you so much, and I'm sorry I missed some of what there was. I thought that what I would be able to bring to this is the perspective from which we learn from the women's organizations, what they are doing. Because I come from the Global Fund for Women, and the way really we learn how women, it's not on? The way we learn about what is happening on the ground is because we have many applications for funding coming from the women's human rights movements. And it's really a good picture because then you know how much women themselves realize what is happening to themselves or do not realize what is happening to themselves, or they are able to bring out things that people may not have thought about before. So I thought I'd begin with a story of a woman I'll just call Esther for the moment. I used Esther because that's a name that doesn't come from the Muslim area, first of all. I wanted to frame it that way. She's Cameroonian, and this is a true story, actually, apart from the name that is disguised. What happened in her case is that she's a lawyer, she's older, and her younger sister was molested by her stepfather. Molested, raped, that's the word I would like to use, by her stepfather. She found out, she wanted to do something about it, so she took her stepfather to court. With her mother's knowledge as well. Anyway, after a long struggle of her being called names and everything else, the women's movements stuck around her, and women lawyers that are connected to the women's movements connected with her and represented her, and she won the case. And after she won the case, the issue, what she asked for was that the father does not have anything to do with this young girl, only 12 years old, and that was granted. But after this case was finished, she actually found out that the law in Cameroon, and this is true, it's based in Cameroon, did not allow the mother or herself to be the caretaker for this young girl by herself. Mm-hmm. But nobody knew about it. She didn't know about it. The mother didn't know about it. And that became another issue altogether, that there are things within the laws that sometimes are not even realized because there are so many single mothers who are taking care of children, and there's nothing comes up until when they were in court and they needed the custody of the child. That's when they came to understand that under the laws there was something that was hidden there that did not allow actually single mothers to raise the children by themselves. And I'm wondering why women aren't taking men to court for not assisting them to raise the children. It's something that has come up from time to time, but I just wanted to use that story to say sometimes we don't always know what is in the laws. And then if I stuck to the Africa situation that I'm very familiar with, and I'll come to the global a little later, many of the countries from which we live really live with many layers of laws, as you all know. In my own country, Kenya, for example, you can do things under Muslim law, under Christian law, under the British law, and under traditional practices. And for as long as you own up for one of those, you're okay and you're covered. So people can get away with quite a lot, and the mixtures that come with all of these particular things, whether it is in the care of children, whether it's in the divorce, or who has the children, et cetera, et cetera. Now, at the Global Fund, I have looked through some of the work that we do, and I find that the framework of women activists who use a lot bringing out the issues of family law really do come from the Middle East and North Africa region. They are more in the naming of it as family law and in the advocacy of the work that they do. In other places, there are things that look like the same things, but very often come to us for grant making under different names. But under family law, we find the majority of the people who actually are doing strong activism and actually naming it as such do come from North Africa and Middle East, or countries that are under Muslim law. So when we're doing the research, what I wanted to be able to say, when doing the research, I think we should go beyond how we name these laws that affect the family, and know that they may exist both under the constitutional laws that are written because in many places because of colonialism,
But they also exist in practices that are so legitimate that they are equivalent to laws as well, whether they are written or not written. But they really govern what happens to the family, what happens to children, the differences in genders and in sexes, et cetera. So in some places you'd find, for example, they also determine who has the children when there is a divorce or a separation. And even in some of the places, if the children are male or female, in some traditions that we have seen some places in Eastern Africa, when there is a separation between couples, the boy children cannot be taken care of by the paternal family. The girl children may be because they are going to be married. Mm-hmm. So there's just a lot of layers of these things that affect the families. So in the groups that we work with that have taken up these issues, they are challenging the bills of many different bills, whether it is the limitations that are given to women traveling, having documentations or not documentations. If we take the Baghdad Women's Association, for example, we have worked with them for a long time, and they have been they have done a lot of publication of some of the work that they do. And their target is usually the decision makers and lawmakers, and what they are trying to call support for is to in the area of the adoption, the laws of adoption. And I think that they do really great work that is worth being looked at. Another organization that we have found that is doing good work is the organization, you told me to tell good news, the Organization of Women's Freedom in Iraq, which organizes to protest, and they have made also really physical protestations in the main square of Iraq, and they do seminars to conscientize women on the family law. These seminars sometimes are targeted towards government officials, they are targeted towards media, and they are targeted towards also women themselves getting to know what is happening. They do these seminars in Arabic, but also there's quite a lot of material that's available in other languages as well for people that are interested. We also have, these are people that we fund and are in connection with. We also have, for example, the Women's Leadership Institute with their advocacy work on awareness campaign to bring again the government to accountability on the international convention that regard to the family law. And so we have in Middle East and North Africa nearly 15 very active groups that are dealing with everything from citizenship to travel, to passport, to clothing, etc., that are really, really good and active at local level, but active towards policy changes. So another area where we have seen some of this creep up is on the people that are working with widows. Because the widows is a very, very specific category that I think that sometimes escapes the feminist work that is happening in the human rights. But there are many groups that are organized specifically to look at the widows. A lot more in sub-Saharan Africa and the inheritance laws that come with the widows, but also the very treatment of widows too, as well. I have heard from some of our activist partners in India that from time to time, and there'll be maybe some of you from here who come from India, that from time to time, even though the law has abolished sati, whenever there is some kind of rise of fundamentalism within a local area, that comes up as well. I would myself even consider practice such as sati, the burning of widows. That's something that should be considered, because it's still institutionally, it was still institutionally, even if it was a cultural institution, it was promoted institutionally. And I tend myself, coming from an oral tradition, I tend to refuse to define these things by written laws alone, because I know that in practice, written laws are important, but many of our countries actually use the cultures and oral histories and everything else, and they sometimes substitute those for the laws that are in the books. So I would simply say that we should be really widening the definitions and actually ending up defining the spheres that we want to deal with in this particular area. Then the third category I've talked about, widows, the third category that I have seen a number of our partner grantees work on is the area of turning back, or shall I say, the age of marriage. There are many countries where in the laws and in the books, the age of marriage has been increased by something like 18 years old. And many countries that are reversing this. We've seen this in Yemen, we saw that in Iran, we saw that in Nigeria, and we are seeing it more and more. And there are many women activists that are working to see that as an issue that should be also very much looked at. And then, of course, the whole area of sexual reproductive health and rights. And that area, too, even though, again, it may not find its definition in family law, but we are seeing a lot of women's movements really concerned. And I think that that is the center of where the biggest discriminations for women come from. The most harm is at the sexual and reproductive health. And I think that we see in our definitions at the Global Fund, we have unashamedly said sexual and reproductive health is going to be a centerpiece of our work, whether we are working with sexualities, whether we are working with the possibilities for women, we are working with the inheritance, but it's really going to be at the center of our work because it does produce a lot of violence. So violence against women, that is an issue, but that is really where it really hurts women most. So I just want to say that when you follow the women's movements, you will really see that they are active, and that's the good news, that there's a lot of consciousness. And I think what is going to happen during this time when we have a specific sustainable development goal on gender equality, these areas of family law are going to help us really bring to the surface a lot of things that often are not said publicly. Thank you.
Thank you very much, and you leave us with a little bit of grain of hope and motivation. Actually, we are running out of time. I wonder, are we confined to the 12 o'clock, or do we have a little bit leeway, given that we started a little late? Because I want to open the floor for questions. Okay, let's see how it goes. Yes, we have a microphone over here, or here too. And please try to ask a question. And let's take four questions as a starter, and then have a second round, please. And introduce yourselves.
Sure. Thank you. A lot of friends on the panel, and thank you for your very strong interventions. Very pleased to be here. Catherine Harrington, I'm with the Global Campaign for Equal Nationality Rights, working for legal reform in nationality laws so that women and men have equal rights to confer their nationality, an issue very dear to Women's Learning Partnership. And WLP has really been a leader in this movement. So to get to my question, there's significant overlap, as you're well aware, between nationality laws and gender discrimination and nationality laws and family laws. 27 countries do not permit women to equally pass their nationality to their own children. 53 have some form of gender discrimination. In countries where there has been reform, where a woman should be able to pass her nationality independently to her child, where family laws permit marriages of different religions or permit women have laws, criminal laws, against women's ability to give birth to children outside of wedlock, there's a contradiction between these laws, where a woman might go to register her child, but then could be have the potential of being thrown in jail. So I just wonder if you could comment on the connection between these laws and the importance of linking reforms where they overlap like this. So thank you so much.
Thank you. Any others? Oh, I was limiting the questions to four, and we don't seem to even have the second. Sorry.
My name is Lillian Oates, and I'm with Presbyterian Women, PCUSA. This is a question for Madeline Reese, actually, for elaboration. You made a statement about when ownership rights, women have ownership rights and certain other rights are recognized, that the level of violence goes down. And then you made another statement, which I don't think I understood properly, there are instances when the level of violence perhaps goes up regarding domestic violence. So I would just like some clarification because I misunderstood the connection there, because I'm thinking, of course, about domestic violence, for example, in the US. A number of years ago, Presbyterian women paid for training in a program we call The Church's Calling, Confronting Violence Against Women. All of you made, obviously, the obvious situation of patriarchy in the church, obviously. And so I would just like for you to elaborate on those two instances that you were speaking of.
Any others? Okay, yes. Well, Yakin, since there's a... Oh, are you...
Yes, sorry. Kent Davis-Packard, Women's Learning Partnership. To Musimbi's point, how can something that is unwritten and unspoken, yet nevertheless practiced, be reformed?
What is the question?
My question is, how can something that is louder? Oh, sorry. Kent Davis-Packard, Women's Learning Partnership. To Musimbi's point, how can something that is unwritten, unspoken, yet nevertheless practiced, be reformed?
Sorry.
Thank you. Thank you for to everybody. Very important what was said. Soraida Abdehsen, Women's Technical Affairs Committee, Palestine. And my question is to Dubraska and anybody that will know what's happening with the reform processes in the UN. Is there anybody seriously taking the responsibility, or should we really reorganize, or what is to be done to reform the UN? I have a lot to say here because stay. The United Nations was formed for certain objectives and now has become a very bureaucratic, I don't know how much budget, and still, there is a lot to say about it. Is there a reform process inside the UN? Where can women put a hand with anybody doing is there, or should women take the initiative, and with all the issues that we are talking about, also talking about this issue together? Thank you.
Thank you very much. You
sort of hijacked
the microphone. Go ahead.
Okay. Thank you. I heard what you say, and it was very important because you try to bring all the context what happened in all the world, especially Mrs. Musimbi. Yes, because it's the reality what is going on in our countries in Southern Africa, especially the culture, the official laws, and these contradictions happen, and we don't know how to deal with all of this. But according to our experience, having just a family law is not enough. We also have a domestic violence bill, bill against women, violence against women bill. So I would like to hear from you if you think that it's enough to put everything on the family law, or we can have different laws and work together with this, or try to have these comprehensive laws. I'm not sure if I managed to get you the point, but this is because a lot of different perspectives. One say that we have to put together one thing, other saying, okay, we have to have different laws and work together with this. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Okay, well, I think perhaps the first question and the last question, there are some overlaps with respect to relations among laws. Just from the perspective of the WLP project, of course, it's called Family Law and Violence Against Women, but clearly the understanding is that any other law that regulates family relationships, marriage, parenthood, relations between man, woman, whether it's nationality law, penal code, or whatever, are, of course, very much part and parcel of that. So those linkages, I'm sure, will be made. But let me turn to the panelists. Would any of you like to comment on that first question?
Thank you very much. This question related to equal nationality rights and discrimination with respect to family laws. I think that you have a very good point. There is overlap and there is discrimination that is interlinked. And if we look at, for example, reservations done with respect to CEDAW Convention, nationality is covered by Article 9 and equality within families in Article 16 and Article 2. And those three articles have the most reservation. So they are the most reserved articles in the CEDAW Convention in terms of implementation. And it is very important to see that those reservations are put by states that are, by those reservations, saying we are still preserving those de jure discrimination with respect to nationality and family status law. With respect to family status law, I think that point was very good in terms of differences with respect to countries and names of different laws, because when we look now at legislation in different countries starting from constitution, we can see that in some countries we also have gender equality laws and domestic violence laws, or violence against women laws. So gender equality laws are covering, let's say, Article 2 of the CEDAW Convention and general issues related to gender equality, empowerment of women, political participation, and things like that. Then there are also laws relating to nationality and relating to family status, but also penal laws. And what was stated by Yakin, it is very important to see that all those laws must be interconnected, they must be in line, because if there is a difference, if there is inconsistency, if there is discrepancy there, then we are seeing that if you avoid discrimination with respect to one law, you are discriminated by the other law. And here I would like to point out that it is very important to use possibilities to challenge laws at the national level and then to go to international level, because this strategic use of possibilities with respect to litigations, it is giving results. So now we are seeing that in many countries nationality laws are challenged and changed through concrete cases done before international organs, be it regional or CEDAW committee. So it is really important to focus on reminding de jure pieces of discriminatory laws and to challenge them. Last point with respect to unwritten laws, those that are governing our lives and that are really not in laws, but they are in our societies as accepted patriarchal norms. Those are really hard to challenge, but we have to encourage all of us to challenge those laws, because we are discovering them, we are knowing them. They are not unknown, we are seeing them. So we have to clearly spell out what is this type of stereotype that should be changed, what is this type of sex and gender-based discrimination that should be spelled out and changed. Mm. Thank you.
Okay, maybe we should just follow.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, just very quick, because I think just to give an example of how this could work, because I think this idea of actually having coherence between law, both national so that it is in accordance with international, is fundamentally important. Just a simple way we can do this, and that is to use the UN system. We have people who have expertly used that system on the panel. But just to say, with regard to personal status laws, for example, it is about using the CEDAW process in order to get expert guidance as to how and in what way the government should respond. We've got a classic example of the civil status law in Syria. When Syria reported before the outbreak of conflict, it refused. Well, there was a documentation, the shadow report actually requested to the CEDAW committee that they comment on the civil status law, which stopped women actually being able to take their children outside the country without the permission of a male relative. CEDAW committee came back, said, yes, you must change this. Government did not. Consequences of the government having failed to comply with the observation of the CEDAW committee was that women who were trying to flee Syria could not do so with their children unless they had the signature of a male relative. When it got more pear-shaped, people were, because it was just total chaos. But just the consequences of that were and are enormous. So the idea of using an existing mechanism in order to be able to get that sort of coherence within law is an element of our activism. So all of you who are contributing to shadow reports must be looking at where that intersection needs to be made and how to get clarity from the committee so that there can be clarity for the government, and then you've got your advocacy entry points for when you have those concluding observations, and then can then try to make real coherence from the national legislation.
Thank you.
Yeah, I would like basically to respond to the last question. The focus on the family relations regulated by family laws or by civil code cannot be only on these kind of codes. Of course, there are the penal code that has to be looked upon. There are labor codes that have to be looked upon. And also, you don't stop there. Because, for instance, even if, going back to our case, the Constitution, besides recognizing that men and women have equal rights and responsibilities in marriage, and I think I didn't say, it also advanced the recognizing diverse forms of family, the issue of violence against women was also mentioned by the Constitution when they say that the state had the duty to prohibit violence within intrafamily relations. That's a paradigmatic shift because in 1988 it's putting the state regulating relations between individuals, which was usually not done and will be in 1993 Human Rights Conference when they said that violence against women is a human rights violation. But on the other hand, this doesn't stop violence against women within the house. And so sometimes you do need specific laws regulating violence against women because what is universal in the penal code does not apply on the same way for men and women, giving exactly the unwritten values, codes, behaviors that are part of society. So we do have a specific law, and many countries do have, on violence against women within the home. So it's really every time you need more laws, but most of all you need to make those laws understandable because many people do not know, do not read the legislation, and thus cannot defend or apply it.
Thank you. Musimbi?
Thanks. I think I'll just briefly say, I think when we are looking for systemic change, we know that there are laws which are good laws that need to be implemented and sometimes are not widely known by the people for whom they are supposed to protect. So there's the whole education aspect of it. Then there are bad laws that are against women that we need to get out of the books. So that's another area of advocacy that is completely important. And then at policy level, we want some new laws because those new laws, we want them to be framed in the way in which we understand justice for women. And that too is another big frame of advocacy work that is needed. And that's where sometimes things that are not written, that we think should be written, because then they can be claimed by more people all over the place, not just in one particular place where they have been defined, is important. And then, in my opinion, the reasons that sometimes we don't even benefit from many good laws is really about people's behavior, cultural changes in the behaviors. For example, on the inheritance, now there are many countries that have good laws on inheritance, but there are also women who resist inheritance. They don't want to inherit the land, or they don't want to have the ownership of children. So we have a lot of work that needs to be done within ourselves and within the laws itself. And laws just by themselves will not get us to the freedom that way we want to, where we want to go, but really continuing to work on people's change of behavior, and cultures do change, oral traditions do change. But where there are also practices that are really good, we have to see how we claim them and make them enhance the laws in particular places. Mm. Yeah.
So Yakin. Laws are important, but it doesn't stop there. There are different levels of intervention. Yes.
I have just answered one question with respect to the what should be done to reform the United Nations. I think that the question was good because it is relevant to focus on constant improvements that are needed. We are seeing that UN is a big monster. And we do see improvements, but in order to have clear results, it is constant work to interconnect and improve different bodies, agencies, and special mandates that are focusing on discrimination against women and violence against women. So it is a constant challenge, because now we do have standards, we do have different recommendations coming from special rapporteurs, but they are not implemented, they are not followed up. We do have different agencies that are now in, working on inclusion of gender perspective in their work, but system is really not yet at the stage as it should be. So it is constant work. We need to focus on improvements and implementation. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I think there were some unanswered issues, but there's also a request for one more question, and then we will have to end the session.
Which question is the question you want to know about the clarification?
Merci. Je m'appelle Julie Cissé, je viens du Sénégal, je vais parler en français et Lina va m'aider après. Donc je félicite les panélistes et je voudrais interpeller Madame Dubravka.
Oui. Lina, are you going to help us?
J'ai eu la chance de rencontrer le groupe de travail des Nations Unies au Sénégal qui travaille sur les violences. Alors je ne sais pas les conclusions, on a bien travaillé avec ce groupe. Si elle peut en parler un peu, mais l'interpeller surtout par rapport au protocole et conventions. Elle a parlé de Maputo, et nous, un article nous intéresse dans le protocole de Maputo, l'article 15, qui parle de la répartition des ressources, équité, égalité dans la répartition des ressources. C'est un problème au Sénégal. Et
this is Julie Cissé from Senegal, and she has a question for Dubravka. She had the chance to work with the UN working group in Senegal on violence against women, and she would like to have an update from you on the work of this group. And you've spoken about conventions, particularly the Maputo Convention, and for them there's an article that is of particular importance in the Maputo Convention, Article 15. On equity and equality in distribution of resources, Article 15 of the Maputo Convention.
C'est pour dire que dans le projet WFP qui nous intéresse, il faut faire cette articulation entre ces violences et les conséquences économiques. Et ça découle de ce non-respect des lois qui marginalise sur le point économique les femmes.
And in our WLP project that we are talking about, we need to make the intersections between these different laws and the impact they have on economic disenfranchisement of women.
Yes.
May I answer? Thank you very much for this question. As a special rapporteur, I have discovered there is no sufficient linkages between global monitoring mechanisms like Special Rapporteur against Violence Against Women and regional mechanisms under Maputo Protocol and Belém do Pará. And as my priorities, I have flagged out importance to link better global agendas with regional agendas and mechanisms in order to focus on implementation. So I am thinking now that majority of countries that have not yet ratified Maputo Protocol and also optional protocol to CEDAW should be really encouraged to do so in order to enable all those possibilities to women from countries that have not yet ratified, to use them in order to challenge and change the situation at the national level. And focus on economic violence is extremely important, because economic violence is a form of violence against women. And now it should be really addressed by all those that are seeing connections and that are seeing how to challenge such types of violence. Recently, Council of Europe Convention was adopted, the Istanbul Convention, and under definitions of what is violence against women and different forms of violence against women, economic violence is also listed. So what you have mentioned in Maputo Protocol is now also in Istanbul Convention, and it is showing that it is general direction that we are now understanding better different forms of violence, but now we have to use those mechanisms that are available. So we have to see ratification of those those instruments that are there and that are not fully used, and also this mechanism, Special Rapporteur on Violence Against Women, could be used better because there are possibilities for country visits, for thematic reports, for communications procedures. So now we have to see how to use different mechanisms in order to focus on concrete results that we would like to achieve. Thank you.
I believe you wanted to...
Just very quickly, just to say that, sorry if I was not clear, but the basic point is that where there is greater inequality within the family unit on the grounds of gender, there is greater propensity for violence. And when you can actually redress that, then there is less likelihood of violence. And we could expand later, but that's the basic premise of the political economy analysis.
Any last minute thoughts from Jacqueline?
Well, I think that it was an interesting and important panel. And I think that although we all know that the connection is there between family laws and civil codes and violence, it is important to really come up with examples, with a systematic research, so that you know, you can go into the open, go into the public, and really advocate for change with solid arguments.
Thank you very much.
Yeah. And I would like to say that this research is going to be very important, and I hope that one of the outcomes will be the expansion of that frame of family law in a way that brings in new findings from the feminist movement.
Thank you very much. I think there has been a lot of wisdom coming out of this panel, which will guide the WLP research. And we will be discussing these issues more and more and perhaps have answers to some of the issues that remain to be a question at the moment. I'd like to thank our panelists for their incredible interventions. And I'd like to thank those of you who have taken the floor to ask questions and those of you who have not asked questions, but for coming and joining us. I believe there was a question on UN reform, but that is a very challenging question in itself, and I don't think that it can be answered within the confines of time that we have. So maybe in the future we'll tap on that too. Thank you all very much. Now I'd like to announce that there is lunch outside. And after lunch, there will be another session, which will be moderated by Kavita Ramdas and three very interesting speakers who are bringing more from the ground experience. So please do join us for lunch and come back for the second session. Thank you.
Thank you, my dears.
That was lovely.